Okay. Laura Rutledge, thank you so much for joining me.
Of course. Thank you for having me.
Of course. So my first question is, what advice would you give to somebody who is looking to pursue a career as a sideline reporter?
So a few things. I think, you know, one of the main things that helped me is I did a ton of radio when I was in college, and it was almost an accident. I literally needed some extra money to pay for some classes because I was taking too many dance classes and my academic scholarship wasn't covering those. And I didn't realize it until my parents were like, what are you doing? And so I went to the on-campus radio station, and that's how I got started, honestly, in this business. And I knew I wanted to do something in media, but I really didn't even know if it would be sports related. And so they had one opening and it was in sports. So anyway, all that to say, I did a ton of radio, and that's kind of how I started. And I think what that did was it allowed me to work on my knowledge base, it allowed me to work on my voice, to work on my personality, all these things that, you know, otherwise I wouldn't have really been able to work on, because when you're on camera and you're thinking about that, that's kind of what your focus is. And it doesn't allow you to, you almost have to develop those other things after you get comfortable on camera. But I found that if you can be comfortable with your knowledge and your personality and your voice and all those things, then being on camera becomes more natural. So it's more of a natural path. So I would recommend, you know, just trying to find a way to get reps on radio and then also get reps with writing and all of that. And it's funny because a lot of people think that sideline reporting is kind of, you know, it wouldn't be writing, right? It's just getting out there and being on camera and all that. But there's so much writing that's involved. And I would say, like, even the amount of times that I'm quickly turning a report around, which could literally be seconds, you are still crafting and writing in your head, you know? So you're still, the second that you get this information, like, okay, you know, this guy is injured and it looks like it's a quad injury and they're, you know, doing this and he's doing some running tests. Like, you're still kind of formulating a written report in your head because you're about to have to regurgitate all the information. Then sometimes you're kind of doing it on the fly as it's happening, but still, there's just so much benefit to being a good writer. And I would say practicing writing is really important just no matter what you want to do in this business.
Perfect. How did you become so knowledgeable about all the sports that you're having to cover?
Oh my goodness. Well, I still always feel like there's more that I could know and more that I could learn. But I will be totally honest, when I, you know, got into this, like I said, it was kind of accidental. And so I really did not have the knowledge base that I needed to have. And it's something that gave me a ton of anxiety early on. And I think, you know, looking back, I really was not, I really kind of fell victim to that anxiety early on, and it would make me so nervous on camera. It would make me like not be able to be who I am, because the whole time I'm thinking, oh no, I'm going to forget this person's name or whatever.
Yeah.
And what I would tell you is that, the worst is, I'm sorry.
Oh, you're fine.
My husband's calling me. Goodbye, Josh. the thing is that like you are going to make these bad mistakes that, you know, it's just going to happen to everybody. Like, nobody's perfect. And I would say that like my worry about knowledge and all of that made me so nervous that I would have struggles where I would make mistakes anyway. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So a few things. I watched a ton of games, and that helped with the knowledge base. And then I also just constantly was researching and kind of developing this ability. And I think it's something that takes experience, but developing an ability to take information that you read or that you get from somebody or however, you know, you're consuming that information and turning it around in something that either sounds like your opinion, is your opinion, or it's kind of a combination of all those things. And that just takes time. And it's something that, you know, I used to, every single report or every single show I would do, I would write everything out, you know, and I'd be like, okay, I'm gonna say all this, I'm gonna memorize it. And I have a decent memory, so I could do that. But it was so hard to memorize, and nothing ever sounded conversational. And so finally, I would even say, like, over the past 2 years, so I'm 31 now, and I've been, you know, doing this since I was about 21. I would even say it's taken until the past, for me, until the past like couple of years to where I really feel like when I'm on TV, I'm just talking and I don't memorize things. And, you know, I'll have a few things that I want to get in, but I'm not like, oh man, I've got to say it exactly this way. And that just takes so much time. So, a lot of patience with the knowledge. Don't be too hard on yourself on that. And there's so many good ways to you know, just continue to do that. I would say once again, like just consuming as much as possible. So whether that's radio, whether it's TV, however you're getting that info, just kind of staying up to date on that.
Perfect. Like you said, you've been doing this for 10 years. I saw that you started off at Fox Sports, correct?
I did.
What would you say, what qualities did you have that like set yourself apart from the rest of your competition? Obviously you were so successful, so young.
No, so, okay, so it's really funny. When I was working at that radio station in Gainesville, when I was in college, my radio boss was like, all right, everybody needs to have a niche. Like, they need to have their thing that they do. And I'm like, well, geez, what's my niche? Because I don't even know what I'm doing. Like, I need a niche. I don't know what I'm doing. So I ended up at the time, and keep in mind, this was like 2008 to 2011. The college football recruiting world was really gaining a lot of steam. And so like the scout.com, rivals.com, that was a really big deal at that point. And I realized that there was not a female presence in it. There were no women that were doing that. And I thought, okay, well, this is going to be my niche. Now, I didn't know what I was doing, so I had to like figure it out. And I was, oh my goodness, I was going to like a million like little high school camps and all these things, because I figure, well, this is just a good way for me to, you know, differentiate myself. So anyway, all that to say, I started doing a radio show that was called The Cheap Seats, and that was like my oh yeah, we stopped moving, so now you're mad. Okay. So that was like my high school radio show. Mm-hmm. And it was high school sports mainly, and it basically was something that was totally different. And so from there, I would just start like tweeting things out about these prospects that were interested in SEC schools, and people started to notice my tweets. And this was when, this makes me seem so old, but Twitter was kind of new. It, like, we didn't even really know what it was. People were like, oh, what is this Twitter thing? So I didn't even really know what I was doing, but I was tweeting things out. And all this to say that like that became a niche that I think separated me from other people. And what I would say to that is like, I do think that a lot of that really was right place, right time. I was also covering Florida during championship runs. You know, the Florida football won a championship in 08 and I was there for that. But what it was that I had some sort of credibility in that space. And so whatever that space is for anybody, it doesn't matter what it is. That may not be what you want to do long term, but I do think that's a really good approach, is say, okay, my expertise is going to be softball, and I'm going to really go all in on that, and I'm going to know everything that there is to know about it. And then, you know, hey, if an opportunity in football comes up, great, I'm ready for it, you know. But you're not kind of pigeonholing yourself, but you are making yourself an expert in something. I do think that sets people apart. You'll see so many people, and you probably see these people even, you know, in your classes at school now, who are like, well, I just want to be a sideline reporter, or I just want to be on TV. And that's great. And I would never discourage anyone from that dream, but like, okay, what am I going to do that's going to be different than that? And that's where, if you can give yourself a leg up by having radio experience and, you know, doing all this other stuff, that really does make a difference.
Thank you. Like you said, you started off, you said there wasn't many women. Was it hard? Did you feel like you had to prove yourself more to like your male coworkers?
Oh yeah. And I mean, honestly, I still do. I would say that it is better by a mile now than it was even when I first got into it. And I think there's a level of, you know, even young men having to prove themselves too. You know, it takes time. I would even say, like, I'll tell you a quick story. When I was 24, I already was doing a lot for Fox Sports, and I worked in San Diego at the time, and I was doing Padres pre and post game show and sideline and all kinds of stuff. So I was doing a lot for 24. So I went and I had a meeting at ESPN, and I was like all excited. I've got this big meeting at ESPN, and I go there and I meet with a few people, and I meet with this one guy, and he says, well, I'm just going to tell you, you're not going to get hired until you're at least 30 here. Like, you're just not going to. We just don't hire people that young, and you've got a long way to go. And I was like, okay, you know, and I took it to heart, and I thought, all right, well, I need to get better. And that happened to me a lot. Like, at that point in my career, I would be told constantly that I was too young and I wasn't ready and all this. And then I ended up getting hired by SEC Network and ESPN that next year. So I was 25 when I got hired by ESPN, which was funny. And it wasn't funny in the way of like, oh, I showed that guy, but it was just, it just proved to me that even though I had that opportunity, I was still going to be considered too young. And I would say, like, it's almost just been recently that maybe I'm not considered too young anymore. And then like, as women, we're kind of in this weird world where, okay, by the time we're 40, we're too old, you know? And that's something that I am trying really hard to break through those issues and all of that. So by the time, hopefully, that you're in this business, you won't have those same problems. But it's just progress that needs to happen. I mean, men are allowed to sort of get old and, like, bless you, and do whatever they want to do, you know, and no one cares, and get fat and get ugly and whatever, and it's fine. And women are not allowed to do that. And I say that sort of tongue in cheek, but I do think that progress has happened, but there's still a lot that we have to prove. And my thing on all that, and this is like my final point on it, is that through all this, I've never felt like, oh, poor me, you know, I have to prove myself. It's like, no, I'm going to take that as motivation. And, you know, I'm never going to use that as an excuse. Like, oh no, they think me, because I'm a woman, they think that I don't know anything. And, oh, I'm so sad. No, like, let me show them that I know what I'm talking about. And I think that has served as, in times when, you know, maybe this becomes a grind in a way or whatever, that has served as constant motivation for me. So, that's the best way to go about it.
No, I love that.
So like, you tell them, mama.
I love it. Reese is here. So my next question is kind of, how do you balance your personal and your professional life? I mean, especially with your husband, like, are you kidding?
Yes. I am still trying to figure it out, to be totally honest. And it's funny because I always thought, you know, I've always wanted kids. I've always wanted, you know, that sort of family life, but I always thought, well, how can I do that with this career? And when I got pregnant, I was like, okay, I'm so excited. But then I was also like, oh no, she's due right in the middle of football season. And I kind of feel bad for that. Like, I always feel like I'll have that, you know, in the back of my mind, like, oh no, I felt that way about her. And I didn't know her. So I didn't know that it was like this little thing, you know, and she's the best thing in the world. But what I realized through all of this is that it really is possible to do all of these things. And it's great perspective to have. And I wish that I had known that sooner, because I think it just, not that I would have been, you know, popping out babies like earlier than I was, I wasn't ready, but I do think that it would have just allowed for less anxiety around all of that. And I was so hard on myself through the whole thing. Oh yeah. Tired. yawn. Oh my God. So cute. I probably came back to work too soon. There were just all these things where, and that was on me. Like, ESPN was like, girl, take your time. And I'm like, no, I need to get back, you know? But I just think it's all, everyone has to experience that the way that they want to. And so I'm still trying to figure out how to balance it, to answer your question. But I do think that there is a little bit of perspective that's provided where you kind of say, okay, just be where my feet are right this second. And especially right now with everything going on, it's like, okay, I'm trying to, you know, do TV from home and like also take care of Reese and all that. But I do, geez, what is that noise? But oh my God, you would, some of the things she's done, like while I've been on TV, I'm like, oh Lord, if people only knew. But what it does show is that it's like, at the end of the day, whatever our job is just a job. And it's just, that's just it. And so it's like, nothing's that important, you know? And I think, except for your family. And so I think that part of it is just good perspective in all this. And I've been really encouraged by the way that, you know, most of my bosses are male, and by the way that they have handled this and their encouragement and, you know, just them saying, hey, whatever you need, take your time, you know, make it work. I also, am still, but like while we were during football season, I was breastfeeding. And so I'm trying to do that, while hosting shows and traveling and craziness was really wild. And it was my decision to do, so I'm not, you know, feeling sorry for myself. But what was amazing is how ESPN supported that. And so I think that's what you'll find. I mean, by the time you're at that point and you're in your life and in your career, things will be even better. But there really is a lot of support from people and a lot of understanding, which is really cool. Oh my god, beautifully said.
Is there anything else you'd like to add to anything?
Just what I would say is just try really hard not to put too much pressure on yourself, because it's so hard to you know, not sit there and compare yourself to others. And Maria Taylor, I feel like, is always just such a great you know, mentor in all this. And mentor is the wrong word, because we're like peers, but she would be a great mentor for you. But she always says that comparison is the thief of joy. And I think that in this business, there's so, especially if you're in a front-facing role, there's so much comparison. And you probably do it now. We all do it. Like, where you look around, you're like, oh, that person has this internship and that person's doing this, and you feel bad about yourself. And it's inevitable that you're going to have those moments. But what I've found is that the times when I've been able to get past that and not compare myself to others have been the most successful times in my life and in my career. So as much as you can avoid the comparison demon, you know, just try to push that aside. And, you know, I'd love to help however I can. So just keep me posted on what's going on with you and how you're doing. And I'm always here to help. Now you know how to find me. Just send me an Instagram DM. Eventually I'll get to it.
Laura Rutledge, thank you so much.